Hey everyone, I'm Nato King, and we're gonna finish up the quests for Ellen in Chapter 5 this time. See what's available as DLC. We actually got two new ones this time, including the conclusion of the Chefro quest. As you may have noticed, Ellen was wearing the Cloak of Twilight in that cutscene, which she definitely didn't have when I first did the quest. Now, for those who are asking whether the game keeps track of that. I think someone is in denial. It clearly happened. Okay, that was really weird. So he says that like it's a timed quest or something that becomes harder the longer it takes you. But there's no such thing. At least we get a reprieve for the first room. Nothing in sight. Surprise! The exit's guarded! And sadly, there's no real gimmick to this quest. It's just, you're fighting Warcadia folks at the same time as you're fighting Endless Corridor folks. And we do have a couple karmas that we need to build up from folks that are in this region. Particularly, defeating Ten Hawk with Balgbulk, and there's two of them in this room. If I see enough Hawk along the way, I might build up this karma and save myself a trip to Warcadia later in the grinding video. Otherwise, this room is pretty tame. Not a whole lot of difficulty here, because it's just the most basic folks from each realm. They will make things a little more difficult. The good news is, no dead ends. They're all completely blocked off, so you only ever fight the folks in the rooms that you have to go to. Though this time we're mixing Patriot with Berlachen. And it might be kinda hard to tell, but I believe Patriot's shield does protect them from Balgbulk's attack, even though it can sort of extend behind them when I throw it in front of them. But it's still effective enough. And once you've completed the first wave, another wave of the same folks appears. And I think that's kinda gonna be the trend for the rest of this quest. Not every room, but there are a few rooms that'll have two waves of folks. At this point, I don't think it's really all that difficult. It's just more to do. On the other hand, fighting a whole bunch of Patriot at once can be a little intimidating. But you can stick Balgbulk right through their shields. Should probably pull out something destroy element, but Balgbulk's getting the job done. Just one little guy left. And the good news is they surround the room with life drops. So at least I don't have to worry about getting into a war of attrition or anything like that. Yeah, it should be no surprise they're going all the way to the end of the realm. And no hawk here. Just a bunch of barragers and patriots and a couple of Garbera. Balgbulk takes care of everything. I think we might have just seen Garbera teleport. Don't really see it do that too often. At least not the way I usually fight them. And it's kinda nice to face off against a wind attack that doesn't track you and hover on top of you until your invulnerability wears off. I kinda miss those days. But we're finally changing things up a little bit and bringing out Gaboy. You remember, they can only be hurt by the destroy element. And if I'm going to use Famor, I need to conserve my MC. Because I can't even use it twice without waiting to recharge. And also, I'm getting pretty cornered. We'll just take out everything else first. I mean, just me and them. Now, I'm not sure I want to wait around to see whether that's actually doing more damage than any of my other attacks. I'm just going to use something that is at least a little more cost-efficient. You know, something that I can use more than once every 10 seconds or so. The good news is I'm getting hit by a lot of wind attacks, but the Cloak of Twilight is doing its job. If I were getting hit by more thunder attacks, then I would be severely worried. I think it would be really nice to have a cloak to protect it against both wind and thunder, but that might just be too overpowered. It would at least be competition for the final cloak. And I guess Skryker and Coropuna working together can actually take a significant chunk out of an enemy's health quickly. Maybe that's why they gave me both of them. So I can just use them both at the same time. I don't know where that Coropuna thought he was running off to. Look at that. Sent him flying. Explosions everywhere. It's like we never left Warcadia in the first place. Now I need a lot of life drops to heal up. And just in case you do forget which door you came in through, the Thunder Crystal is always next to the exit. There should just be one more room and then the mini-boss. And we got Answer and what looked like Spriggan this time. Only there's no Spriggan in this room. I have no idea what those circling rocks were about. Anyway, the downside is we've got bullseyes here, and they're probably the worst of the Warcadia folks. As you can see, I'm running into a hail of gunfire. And while I could probably keep Spriggan up long enough to block it all, then that sort of leaves me defenseless and surrounded by enemies. So I really want to keep on the move here as much as I can. I never noticed how weird their screams sound when you're capturing bullseyes. It's funny.
Yeah, blah, 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 blah.
Alright, and Bog Bulk turns out to be very effective against everything in this room. Bullseyes are really weak to it. I think that was just one hit. And I think it gets right through the Answerer's shields, too, because Answerer can only block one hit. Bog Bulk can do several in a combo. So, back to Destroy Element. Give Fomor one more chance. That wasn't really a whole lot of damage for my entire MC meter. Besides which, Gargantua can get through that lightning shield. And the exit opens, and we can go to the final room of this quest, where undoubtedly the hardest challenge awaits. I realize I'm being kind of sarcastic, but it is the toughest challenge of this chapter, I think. Yep, we got a Spriggan, we got Answer, and we've got several Warthog. All in this one room. Which, you might have noticed, is kinda small. Fortunately, Bog Bulk still manages to be effective against Warthog, at least when they're on the ground. I was kinda confused about the fact that the vertical pillar of lightning that comes down to the ground from Bog Bulk doesn't hurt enemies if it hits them. Or at least it doesn't appear to. But since everything except Spriggan is very vulnerable to thunder, I think a dual attack of Bog Bulk and Gaboy should get the job done. You might have noticed there, Bog Bulk took a solid hit from Spriggan and just kept using its attack. It's a real trooper. I think really early in the thread, someone said that pretty much every chapter they would stop using the old folks and start using the new ones that they got in that chapter. Whereas I stuck with a lot of the early game ones just because those were the ones I was the most familiar with. Having used some of the later game ones now, I can kinda see the point. I don't necessarily agree with it, I still think every folk has its place, even at the very end of the game. But there are certainly advantages to the later ones. And I'm making a dent in the number of enemies in the room here. We'll finally get that double capture. Just one more warthog to take down before Spriggan catches up to me. It's possible that I could have captured one or two of them. I mean, they are beat, and I'm getting pretty good at that. Oh, hey, green ore. Remember when I really, really agonized about having to get those? That was a long time ago. Though, we gotta switch to the slash element to take down Spriggan effectively. Well, I'm pretty sure destroy works, just doesn't draw out its id. Using the slash element makes it a little bit faster because I can capture it rather than having to kill it completely. And I don't know whether you can even kill it in one cycle. It seems like you can, but you'd have to use something pretty powerful to do it. And maybe Fraxinus wasn't necessarily the most efficient choice. Could do something like Ogma where I can do a couple of hits per time, but it got the job done. And with this capture, that'll be the end of this quest. And finally. And our reward is yet another new rare folk for that very, very sad quest. And also the story was pretty sad too. So Footcampus is a water element folk, and one of its karmas needs that red liquid that we got from the Mystery Messenger quest. Probably the most useful of the karmas, but it doesn't really make it a very good folk. We'll see that one in the grinding video too. And probably nowhere else ever. So just one quest left, and after that last one, I think this one's pretty anticlimactic. Yeah, I wouldn't call this a bad quest by any means. It just doesn't have any really deep story significance. It's just fighting. Fun fighting, but fighting. And we start at the midpoint for some reason. Yeah, we're pretty familiar with the tower by now. But there's a bit of a twist. So let's head up the tower. Yep, can't save it. Not that I really wanted to. I needed all the quests in a single segment with no saves, but not really anything particularly dangerous most of the way. Just in addition to the timer, we've got gimmicks for each floor. It may not seem like that difficult a gimmick, but at the very least I've been warned. So, pick a couple of folks that are good for hitting large numbers of Fahan at once. Probably should have put Rhinek on the circle button, but didn't really know how many of them there were going to be. And as you can see, it doesn't take very long to draw out the red ids, but one of them is now away from the pack, so I can't get all of their ids at once. And by the time I find a good angle, they're already waking up. So, a minute and a half is pretty tight timing for this quest. Especially when I just kind of give up and I know I'm not capturing all of them, but I need to do something. At least reset things, get them all back to full health so I don't accidentally kill one of them in the attempt to capture them. Plan to barrage her off in completely the wrong direction. But that's almost all of them. I think they may be close enough. I count 6 tendrils, so... got them all. This one, honestly, doesn't seem all that bad. I mean, it's pretty much exactly what we encountered when we fought Keg for real. And I don't know whether this quest becomes available if you haven't caught one yet. It could be that this is the quest where you find your first Keg. And the helpers are bats, so of course I'm gonna go with Garbera. And the real trick here is trying to capture the bats without doing too much damage to a keg. Because you've seen how easy it is to kill them if you do physical damage. I think that's all of the bats. Now I just need to put both of the keg to sleep so that I can capture one of them. Capture the one that's closer to waking up. Really not that difficult to challenge at all. And I'm pretty sure those crystals have life drops in case you need them. This gimmick, again, not particularly difficult. You just really have to pay attention to what you're doing. And I'm going to grab a folk that's effective against Balewind, because I know I'm going to be fighting some, but really you've just got to attack the ones that aren't Balewind. I think leaving it till last is probably for the best, mostly because I am wearing the Cloak of Twilight, so the wind attacks aren't going to hurt me as much as the rest. And also, Garbera is not going to hurt a Balewind at all, so I'm not going to accidentally kill it while I'm going after the other two. As you can see, now there's two Balewinds, and I've just got to kill the Baethyr without bringing either one of them down. Now, I start attacking the Balewind before realizing the replacement for the Baethyr is a Balgbulk. I gotta kill this guy to make a Balewind appear. And of course, killing a Balewind will cause a Baethyr to appear. But I'm not going to do that. Now it's 3 Balewinds, and now it's time to finish this floor. See, I'm not too worried about the wind attacks, and I kind of want to save my MC for just pounding on these guys with Gaboy until they're all down. And since it is the elevator to the top, they all drop life drops, although just small life drops on this floor. Well, see, that's the thing. It should affect my strategy, but in the end, it kinda doesn't. I never said this quest was tame. We've got two Moralta Bagalta to fight at the same time. So, of course, we need both sleep and charm attacks. I really have no idea why I went with Kobli now. Probably the worst choice of charm folk. As you can see, I'm not even affecting them. And just when I managed to get in what would have otherwise been a solid hit, it changes forms, now I gotta use sleep. So, the annoyance factor is just really high in this point. And I'm also taking a whole bunch of thunder element damage, which I'm not really prepared to defend against. See, I haven't really managed to do a whole lot to them, so I don't think capturing these Rhinox is going to cause a problem. And I really, really need the health, which I lose almost as soon as I've collected it. You can tell I wasn't really prepared for what this fight was going to throw at me. But there is a good strategy to be found here, and I'll find it. I'll succeed in this quest. The good news is, you can at least draw out Moralta Bagalta's ids using attacks that aren't going to damage the Rhinox. And really, you've just got to be careful not to kill a Rhinox. Also, we've got all these crystals around the edge which have large life drops in them. So health isn't as much of a threat as I thought it was going to be. You also got to notice when you actually do draw the red ids out of these guys, so that you can get in there and actually start killing them. There, I think I accidentally killed a Rhinox just by hitting it too much. And then the Moralta Bagalta will recover all their health. I have to start over from scratch. You can probably guess it's not going to be possible to capture these guys in the middle of this quest. Nope. There we go. Kill a Rhinox accidentally, and they fully recover. It's not that they have a whole lot of health, it's just hard to whittle it down, particularly when you're trying to avoid hitting all sorts of other enemies in the arena. Puka's probably a bad choice for this anyway. I should most likely be using something more like Boggart. Something that allows me to surgically, precisely hit exactly the enemy I'm going after. But I think it's at about this point where I realize what the good strategy is. Because both Habitrot and Kushi are going to stun any Rhinox that are in the area right away. You get into the thick of things, summon one of them, and it'll, you know, put all the Rhinox to sleep or charm them. Whereas the Moralta Bagalta is just going to take a bit of damage and keep coming after you. So that way, you can lead the boss away from the big group of enemies, and then fight it on its own without a whole lot of interference. And admittedly, there are so many Rhinex that by the time you've put the last ones to sleep, the first ones will be recovering again. But by this point, I think I've got a handle on what I'm doing. All I gotta do is, I think, go through one more repetition of this, try to lead him away from the pack before I go stunning him completely. And that'll do it. And for doing all that work, we get a bunch of purple dust, which I'm practically swimming in at this point. But again, I like the quest, I like the fighting with gimmicks. And unfortunately, that's the last of the quests for this chapter. Nothing new has opened. So I'll see you guys next time with my special guest as we talk about some stuff from this chapter for the grinding video.